go ahead and get started. Lots to cover. All right, I just want to just highlight what we covered last time, just to make sure, because it's going to be what I'm doing today is an extension of what we did last time. We're learning the quick and fast rules on how to take derivatives of certain functions. Now, these are the basic rules that you have pretty much memorized. The derivative of a constant is always zero. Derivative of x, or a variable by himself, whether it be t or y or z or whatever variable you want, the derivative of a variable, x in this case, is 1. Derivative of a constant times x is just a constant coefficient out front. This is called the power rule. The derivative of x to the n is n x to the n minus 1. Derivative of constant times n x to the n, you basically constant holds over, and you get n x to the n minus 1. So you get that constant times n x to the n minus 1. And then we had what we call the constant rule. The derivative of constant times a function is the derivative of that would be a constant times the derivative of the function. Constants hold over. And then you got the sum and difference rule. When you take derivative of either addition or subtraction between functions here, you take derivative of each one and then you add it or subtract it. These were your basic rules. And the most important out of all these guys was clearly the power rule. Derivative of x to the n, you take derivative of that is n x to n minus 1, which means we don't have to do all this limit as h goes to 0 of f of x plus h minus f of x all over h stuff to be able to take derivatives, because someone has gone before you and have figured out what the pattern is. But these are your basic rules. So where we're at today is the next section, section 3.6, product rules and quotient rules. Now, before we get started on this, one other thing I want to talk about here. And so let me get a nice little clean sheet of paper just to give you a little background of understanding this stuff. Now, we have here y equals some kind of a function. Then, remember, in calculus, notation is everything. So this is your function, y or f of x. Call it either one, or it could be f of t or f of y or whatever function you happen to have in terms of whatever variable. We like this notation, the functional notation, because f, we name the function, and inside the parentheses tells me what the independent variable is. Now, that being said, we also have y prime is equal to f prime of x. This is the notation for the derivative, okay? But this is also equal to dy over dx, which is also equal to df over dx. All these things mean derivative. Why? Well, to understand the concept of calculus, you got to go basically do a little math history on this thing. Who developed calculus? That's right. Newton and some other mathematician. You happen to know what his name is?
Yeah.
Leibniz. Very good. Two guys. Sir Isaac Newton and Leibniz. And depending on where you studied in Europe, who actually gets credit for calculus? If you are study in the British Isles or happen to be a former British colony as we are, we give credit for calculus to Sir Isaac Newton. However, if you study calculus in Europe or in Russia or some places like that, Eastern Europe and the like, they give credit to Leibniz. So it depends on where you study in the world of who gets credit for the calculus. But the reality is both of them discovered this stuff about the same time. You know, so in mathematics, who gets credit for it is the guy who published it first. So Leibniz actually, what I understand, published it first, but not Newton, and his notes were actually dated that he was actually submitting to these places, not to be published, but to submitting to places for confirmation stuff, actually predated Leibniz. So they fought back and forth between who actually discovered the calculus. Now, Sir Isaac Newton came from England, Great Britain, and he came up with the notation for the prime. Actually, we come up, years later, we actually came up with the prime. He actually came up with the dot notation. That's what he called the derivative, y dot, okay? But we're math people, we got lazy, the dot kind of slid to the back a little bit and came across a hash mark, because math people write so fast because we don't actually pay attention to what we're writing down. And eventually it showed up as this notation, but this was the original Sir Isaac Newton notation. Leibniz was from where? Where was he from, you know? German. What do you guys know about the Germans? Well, granted, they like to declare war on everybody twice in the past century, but they kept losing. What else? They're very detailed when it comes to mathematics. Leibniz came up with this notation. Now, what exactly is the derivative? You understand the German mindset behind this, then you'll understand the notation. This was just, he had to give it a notation, so there's no rhyme or reason behind his notation. That's his Newton. Germans, there's always rhyme or reason behind their notation. Learn that. All right, so when you're studying German or physics and things like that that have a German ancestry, remember, there's a reason for what they do. Here's the deal. What exactly is the derivative? You've been programmed personally by me. When you think of derivative, what do you think of from a geometric perspective? The slope of the tangent line. Slope of the tangent line. What's the formula for slope? Okay, y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. Let's get a little deeper into math notation. It's the change in y over the change in x. What is the symbol in mathematics for change? Okay, it looks like a triangle, but it's actually a Greek letter. Delta, all right? It's delta. And now don't think too deep in the notation here. What letters does delta start with, even in German?
D.
Okay. dy over dx, because this represents the slope of the tangent line, but it still has that slope perspective. So this is the Leibniz notation. However, you are 21st century math students, hence you're going to have to know both notations. Whether you study in Eastern Europe or you study in England, we don't care. You got to know both. So Leibniz notation, Isaac Newton notation, but it's all the same thing. So if you have dy over dx or y prime or df over dx or f prime, it means the same thing. It's the notation for the derivative. But the German, the Leibniz notation, is a lot more detailed in this stuff. So, and you'll appreciate this notation, especially when you get into calculus 3 and things like that. Actually, for you guys next semester, when you get the multivariable calculus stuff. Okay, so. All right, so noticing that, back over here. We are in chapter 3.6. We're going to start taking derivative of harder stuff. Well, how do we define harder stuff? We're going to first start looking at products and quotients and eventually functions inside of functions called compositional functions and how to take a derivative of harder stuff. Right here, if you've got f of x is equal to g of x times h of x, this is a product. This is called the product rule. Your book says f prime of x is equal to g prime of x times h of x plus g of x times h prime of x. This is using the Newtonian notation, Sir Isaac Newton, okay? Or you could use the Leibniz notation, okay? The d of g times h over dx. That means take derivative of g times h with respect to x. That's equal to the derivative of g with respect to x times h plus g times the derivative of... There's a typo on this stuff, as opposed to being H. Get your notes. I always find a typo when I'm actually reading this stuff, and I never go back and fix it later for next semester. So it's dh over dx. So it's derivative of g with respect to x times h plus g times derivative of h with respect to x. But honestly, this is great in terms of notation stuff, but what you really got to memorize is the pattern. So the way I have my students memorize this stuff is this. If you got y equals g of x times h of x, then y prime is equal to g prime of x times h of x plus g of x times h prime of x. Now, let me put this to you guys in English because that's nothing but a formula. What you really have here is the derivative of the first times the second plus the first times the derivative of the second. And that's what I'm going to drum into your mind. It's drew the first times the second plus the first time drew the second. Let me explain and go ahead and lay it out for you guys what I'm doing and why I'm doing it. We are going to pack on this stuff on top of you guys. We're going to do products. In just a few minutes, I'm going to do the quotient rule. Later on, I'm going to do something called the chain rule. And then what we're going to do here is take all these rules and intermix them. We're going to take rid of really nasty stuff, things that have products and quotients at the same time. To be able to take rid of the hard stuff, you got to get the rules down in your mind, because you got to look at the big picture and focus on the big picture rule. If I'm taking the derivative of a product, you just don't take derivative of the first, time derivative of the second. It doesn't work like that. To take derivative of a product, you have to use what we call the product rule. It is the derivative of the first times the second plus the first times derivative of the second. So you'll notice this rule, half of it honestly is just recopying the formula. Take derivative of the first function times the second function, just copy the second function, plus the first function times the derivative of the second function. So here's an example right here that I actually typed up for you guys. F of x is equal to 2x cubed plus 8x times 5x to the fourth plus 17. Honestly, there are two ways I could take rid of this function. One, I could use John's fundamental theorem of calculus. What's John's fundamental theorem of calculus? I could clean this thing up first. How would you clean this up if you really wanted to? Pull it out, right? You know, 2x cubed times 5x to the 4th plus, you know, outer, inner, last. You could pull this thing out and then take rid of each term. You get the same answer, okay? But we want to jump into the derivative quite quickly. So we're trying to introduce a rule here. So because the big setup is a product, this is what I'm calling the first function, the 2x cubed plus 8x. I'm calling the second function 5x to the 4th plus 17. I'm going to use the product rule. Derivative of the first times the second plus the first times derivative of the second. Derivative of the first, what is the derivative of 2x cubed plus 8x? 6x squared plus 8. Straight up, know your rules. Bring down the power, 2 times 3 is 6x squared plus derivative of 8x is just 8. That's derivative of the first guy times the second. I just recopied the second function. Plus the first function, I just recopied the first function. And then I multiply times the derivative of the second. What's the root of 5x to the 4th plus 17? 20x cubed, officially plus 0, right? But we don't have to write plus 0. And that is my answer for the derivative. Okay? Now, I didn't say clean it up. And here's also the deal. I'm going to give you guys a real special gift on this stuff. When it comes to your next test, which is coming pretty soon, but I still got some more sections on material to cover with this stuff because I got to get you guys really well with this stuff. I'm going to ask you to do something that a mathematician rarely ever asks his students. I'm going to ask you not to clean it up. So the reason why, if I actually did this problem and I wanted a real answer, I would fold out the first guy, distribute the second term throughout, and then combine my terms. That would give me my answer. But I'm going to ask you not to do that. The reason why is for grading purposes. I'm going to make sure you guys understand the rules. So if you leave the answer just like this, I can see the derivative of the first times the second plus the first times derivative of the second. And that's what I'm looking for in making sure that you understand the concepts. Don't worry, we're going to get to word problems later where I'm going to have to set this sucker equal to zero and you're going to have to do all kinds of interesting algebra to manipulate and solve. That's your future. It's coming down the road. But right now, I'm trying to make sure you understand how to take these elusive derivative functions, these first and second derivatives, because we are going to eventually go back and focus on velocity and acceleration and throw some physics at you guys, okay? So we're going to ask you to not clean it up. Just some little side notes over here, some common derivatives here, and just to practice, and I did these last time, but I just wanted to show you guys you're going to see a lot of this stuff. Like if you want to take the derivative of the square root of x, okay? Well, basically, y equals x to the 1/2 power, because I don't do square roots. But what is the derivative? Well, once you write radicals as fractional exponents, they're exponents. I get used up the power rule. What's the derivative of x to the 1/2? Well, you take the derivative would be you bring down the exponent 1/2, x, and then you subtract 1. Negative 1/2. You with me? But where does the negative exponent go if you're going to clean them up? back on the bottom to the denominator down there with the 2, because you have, do have a fraction up front here. And then what exactly is a half power? Square root. So the answer would look like this. You'll see that in the back of the book. 1/2 √x. Okay? And this is me working it out over here. Okay? Same idea on this one. I don't do things in the denominator. If I got x in the denominator to a power, I always want to clean that sucker up. And I clean it up by bringing them to the top and making the exponent negative. So, just watch this one. This is 1/x, derivative 1/x. 1/x is the same thing as x to the negative 1. So when I take my derivative of this guy, again, I'm going to use my power rule. The exponent pops out front. This is negative 1x to subtract 1. Minus 1 minus 1 is minus 2. And then, of course, what you do is you clean that up. Negative exponent goes on to the bottom. And that's where I get negative 1/x². These are pretty popular and things you need to remind yourself of when you're actually trying to clean up some of this stuff. So, let's take a look at a couple of these guys right here. Number one, f of x is equal to x to the 4th plus the square root of x times 5x minus 1. I want to take rid of this guy. First things first, even if I don't want to fold it out, because looking at the square root's not going to be that nice, I am going to clean it up. I don't do square roots. What's a square root? Half a power. So x to the 4th plus x to the 1/2 power times 5x minus 1. So now, and again, labeling is everything. So if this function's called f of x, I'm about to take its derivative. Its derivative is called f prime of x. Labeling is everything. You'd be amazed how many students will screw up these problems by not labeling their derivative. They just have f of x equals, then they put equal to, and then they start taking derivatives, and that's a violation of the rules. You got to label everything. This is f prime of x, and I see a product, hence I'm going to use the product rule. Product rule, you take derivative first, which will be 4x cubed plus derivative x to the 1/2 is 1/2 x to the negative 1/2. The derivative of the first times the second, 5x minus 1, plus the first, x to the 4th plus x to the 1/2, times derivative of the second. What is the derivative of 5x minus 1? 5. That's what we want for the answer. Now, of course, if you cleaned up this part and wrote him as his cleaned up version, which we actually talked about up here, that would have been fine, but that's about as much as I want you to do. So the answer I would look for is 4x cubed plus 1/2 √x times 5x minus 1 plus x to the 4th plus x to the 1/2 is pretty much square root of x times 5. That's pretty much the way I want you to leave the answer. If you do a little individual cleanup, that's okay with me, but I don't want you to fold it out and combine like terms, because once you do that, I can't see the product rule or the quotient rule in action, and I'm really trying to test you guys on that stuff. Does that make sense? All right. Let's take a look at this guy over here. Just because I want to be different, let's call him g of x. G of x is equal to x squared plus the square root of x times x to the 2/3 power minus 7x. I want you to take derivative of it. First thing I'm going to do here is clean them up slightly. This will be x squared plus, I don't do square roots, that's x to the 1/2 power, times x to the 2/3 power minus 7x. Now, I see a product, hence I'm going to use the product rule. Labeling it, this is g prime of x equals product rule. Derivative the first times second plus the first times derivative the second. Derivative the first. Derivative of x squared plus x to the 1/2 is 2x plus derivative x to the 1/2 is 1/2 x to the negative 1/2. Derivative the first times the second, recopy it, x to the 2/3 power minus 7x. Officially plus, ran out of room, so I'm going to run down to the second line here. Plus the first, just recopy it, x squared plus x to the 1/2 times derivative the second. What is derivative of x to the 2/3 power? 2/3. X to the subtract 1, you get negative 1/3 power. Minus, what's derivative of 7x? 7. And there's my derivative. Honestly, that's the way I want you guys to leave it. Now, again, you could, if you wanted to, clean up this 1 half x to negative 1 half and make it 1 over 2 squared of x. In terms of this guy, you could put the negative exponent in the denominator, make it 2 over 3 times x to the 1 third power. And if you really, really wanted to, a 1 third power is also known as a what? Cube root. You can write them as a cube root. But other than that, I really don't want you to mess with this thing. And if you left it like this, I honestly will be happier, because I'm after you guys understanding the basic rules. True the first times second plus first times true the second. That is the product rule. Okay? Turn the page. Well, if you can do products, you can do quotients. Now, first off, what exactly is a quotient? That is a big, long division, right? Fraction. Garbage on top, garbage on bottom. Big old function here, right? And I want you to take rid of this thing. Well, here it is. I got g of x over h of x. F of x is equal to g of x over h of x. Then f prime of x would be g prime of x times h of x minus g of x times h prime of x divided by h of x squared. I could use the Leibniz notation here. D of g over h dx, and there's a typo again, because you can see I cut, copied, and pasted where I got my notes from, so it's the same typo as before. It is d g dx times h, drew the top guy, times h minus g times, what would this be? Dh over dx, the derivative of the h function, all over h squared. Now, in writing this thing in English, here's where the real deal is. So if I have here f of x is equal to g of x over h of x, then f prime of x would be equal to g prime of x times h of x minus g of x times h prime of x over h of x squared. Now in English, just like we did the product rule, was drew the first times second plus the first times derivative of the second. The quotient rule is this. It's the derivative of the top times the bottom minus the top times the derivative of the bottom all over, that's that big long division thing, all over the bottom, what? So, and I typed it up for you down here. Let's drew the top times the bottom minus the top, trying to drew the bottom all over the bottom squared. Now, I'm trying to drum this into your head. Honestly, my goal for you guys is this. When you go to bed at night, the first thing that should pop into your head is calculus class. And the next thing that should pop into your head is my voice saying things like through the first times the second plus the first time through the second, or maybe through the top times the bottom minus the top trying to through the bottom all over the bottom squared. Getting these rules down, because this is how you make an A in this class, memorizing these formulas. So let's take a look at this function right here. I got f of x is equal to 2x cubed plus 8x divided by 5x to the fourth plus 17. It's clearly a quotient, a big fraction, where the 2x cubed plus 8x is in the numerator. The 5x to the 4th plus 17 is in the denominator. To take a derivative of a quotient, you just don't get to take rid of the top over to the bottom. That would be way too easy and would be wrong. To take rid of a quotient, you actually have to take rid of the top. And rid of the top, rid of the 2x cubed plus 8x is 6x squared plus 8. To rid of the top times the bottom and just recopy the bottom, 5x to the 4th plus 17. Minus the top, just recopy the top, 2x cubed plus 8x, times the derivative of the bottom. Derivative of 5x to the 4th plus 17 is 20x cubed, plus 0 officially, 20x cubed, all over the bottom squared. Just recopy the bottom, 5x to the 4th plus 17 squared. And this is what your answer looks like. And again, this is the way I want you to leave your answer. So, take a look at these problems here. I have here x to the fourth minus 8x divided by 2x minus 1. And I say, take derivative. What do you see? I see 4x cubed, well, I see x to the fourth minus 8x all over 2x minus 1. The first thing I see is I see a quotient. So what am I going to use? Quotient rule. Labeling is everything in calculus. And the quotient rule, again, drumming it into your head, is derivative of the top times the bottom minus the top times derivative of the bottom all over the bottom square. On your mark, get set, go. Derivative of the top. What's derivative of x to the fourth minus 8x? 4x cubed minus 8. Derivative of the top times the bottom, just recopy the bottom, 2x minus 1. Minus the top, x to the fourth minus 8x, times the derivative of the bottom. What's derivative of 2x minus 1? 2. All over, one big old long division there, the bottom, just recopy the bottom, 2x minus 1 squared. And that's what I want to say. So I want to see that derivative of the top times the bottom minus the top times derivative of the bottom all over the bottom squared. Now, honestly, if I had to, quote, clean this thing up, I would fall out this first term. This is a negative 2. I put them out front, and then I would distribute the negative 2. The 2, as well as the negative sign, would distribute. Then combine like term all over 2x minus 1 squared. That's what the cleaned up version of the answer would be, but I don't want to see that. Don't worry. I'll get you on the algebra later when we start doing applications of this stuff. Right now, this section is about how do I take derivative of really hard stuff? Take a look at this next guy. I've got x squared plus 2x divided by the square root of x. First thing I would do is just clean them up slightly. This is x squared plus 2x divided by x to the 1/2 power. Now, officially, if I wanted to clean them up, I could just take x to the 1/2 and put it under each term and then just clean them up and then take derivative of it. But no. I'm putting a gun to your head. I'm saying, yeah, use the quotient rule on this thing. Show me what the derivative is. Okay? Quotient rule. Labeling is everything. You don't label, you don't pass. That simple. This is L of x, therefore I want the derivative, which will be called L prime of x. I see a quotient, hence I'm going to use the quotient rule. Quotient rule is derivative of the top. What's derivative of x squared plus 2x? 2x plus 2. Derivative of the top times the bottom. Just recopy it. X to the 1/2 power. Minus the top, just recopy the x squared plus 2x, times the derivative of the bottom. What's the derivative of x to the 1/2 power? 1/2 x to the negative 1/2 power, using my famous power rule. All over the bottom, x to the 1/2 squared. And honestly, you leave it like that and I'm happy. I know, it's going to bother a lot of you people to see x to the 1/2 squared. Because x to the 1/2 is also known as what? Square root of x. And when you square root of x and you square it, what are you going to get? X. And if you like clean that up, I don't know if I take off points or not. Probably not. It just makes me mad. Leave it alone right now. I want to see the action in terms of the product rule and the quotient rule. Because in a minute, you're going to see it's going to get very tough on you guys. Does that make sense? Turn the page. I'm trying to show some more examples on you on what this thing can do. But we haven't really talked much on trig yet. So I'm going to introduce some trig to you guys just so I can see the rules. And I will discuss this trig later when I actually introduce trig to you guys. But I just borrowed a problem, which was a great problem to study. So I just wanted you guys to see it. So this was one that you're going to see in your future web work, especially after I get rid of the trig. But I haven't done it yet, but I want you to see what's coming down the road. So, I'm going to give you this right here. Give you some information. This is a puzzle game. This is a web work puzzle game. F of pi 6 is 7. F prime of pi 6 is negative 5. They just tell you this stuff. And they said, let g of x be equal to f of x times cosine of x. And let h of x be equal to sine of x divided by f of x. You're supposed to find two things. G prime of pi 6, and the other one's going to be h prime of pi 6. Now, just a little note, because we haven't discussed it yet, but I'm going to right here, and I will prove it to you later, but here's your little note. If y equals the sine of x, then y prime is equal to what's the root of sine of x? cosine of x. I haven't proved it to you, just take my word for it right now. I will go back later and scare you with the proof on it, okay? But right now, just remember this. If y equals sine of x, derivative of sine of x is cosine of x. Also, let's see if you guys can catch a pattern. If y equals the cosine of x, what is the derivative of the cosine of x? Almost, it's negative sine of x. It's sine of x, you're right, you're having that shifting over aspect to it. But the derivative of cosine of x is actually negative sine of x. Again, I will prove this to you later and to scare you guys. But I'm just going to give you this one right now, okay? I'm giving you the function. Derivative of sine of x is cosine of x. Derivative of cosine of x is negative sine of x. My question is, because we haven't hit trig yet, we're going to. I would like to know, in this brand of strike, what you guys remember about your trig class from high school. Good, that's one thing. I could never spell that, so I could never do that problem. Sakatoa. P-H-Y, I have no idea, Sakatoa. So that's how you do right triangle trig, was it Sakatoa? S-O-H-C-A-H-T-O-A. And what that stands for is sine is opposite over hypotenuse, cosine is adjacent over hypotenuse, tangent is opposite over adjacent. What I remember is a little mnemonics that my teacher taught me. I always write, if you ever look at your calculator, you got sine, cosine, and tangent, okay? So, we're talking about trig. Let's talk about trig for just a second. The things you need to know, trig, sine, cosine, tangent of an angle. Okay, put it up here. Sine, cosine, tangent. If you happen to have a right triangle, you focus on one of the angles that's not the 90-degree angle. I shall call him this guy, theta, in honor of the Greeks. We shall call the angles Greek letters usually, theta. According to this triangle, the side straight across or opposite the side of theta is called the opposite side, because we're math people, don't think too deep and I would come up with names and stuff. The side that touches the angle down here at the bottom is called the adjacent. And adjacent means touching. And the longest side, the side opposite the 90 degree mark, is called the what? Hypotenuse. You know several things about right triangles. One of the most important things is what we call the Pythagorean theorem. You probably know it as a squared plus b squared equals c squared. In terms of this setup, you should know it as opposite squared plus adjacent squared is equal to the hypotenuse square, right? Now, what the Greeks discovered and developed 1,500 years ago, almost 2,000 years ago now, is the relationship on right triangles to an angle to respective sides and the fractions of sides. The definition, this is nothing but a definition, the sine of an angle is equal to what? What's sine equal to? The opposite over the hypotenuse. Cosine of theta was equal to the adjacent over the hypotenuse. And the tangent of theta was equal to what? The opposite over the adjacent. And they understood the relationship between the angle and the respective ratio of sides. And they also understood from the Pythagorean theorem the relationship of the sides to each other. Also, the relationship of the angles. What's the sum degrees of a triangle equal to? 180 degrees. Okay? So they understand lots of aspects on triangles. Now, what we were talking about just a few seconds ago is the memorization of this. Sine, cosine, tangent. Now, you mentioned Sakatoa. Well, where that comes from is S-O-H-C-A-H-T-O-A, and this is the mnemonic, the way of memorizing the relationship of sine, cosine, and tangent. My problem was when I was in school, I couldn't spell Sakatoa. I was real good at math. English, not so much. Okay? So, Sakatoa. How would you spell that? Like I said, P-H-Y. I have no idea how to spell Sakatoa. And my teacher saw me struggling with Sakatoa when I kept scratching my head going, what Indian tribe is that? I don't know Sakatoa. So my teacher taught me other ones. If you ever look at any calculator, The buttons are always in the same position. Sine, cosine, tangent. Right? It's always in order, from left to right. Sine, cosine, tangent. My teacher taught me, oh heck, another hour of algebra. That was an awesome one. You can also know what generation my teacher was into when they were teaching me, or what generation they were from. There was another one they taught me. Some old hippie caught another hippie tripping on acid. Way 1960s, 1970 something or other there. And then there's a few more that I can't say in public company with ladies present that I can mention to you guys on how to memorize this stuff. My teachers were, quote, cool. All right, so I'm not going to teach you those because I'm not cool. I'm just a professor. All right. But I don't care how you memorize it. Memorize it. The relationships of the right triangle trig stuff. And we're going to get into the calculus behind this stuff. But these are things you need to know. Also, other things you need to know. The special angles of certain, you know, special trig values of certain angles. Like, for example, do you guys happen to know this? What is the sine of pi 6 equal to? What is the cosine of pi 6? What is the sine of pi 4? What is the cosine of pi 4? And wait a minute, there's two more here. What is the sine of pi thirds? And what is the cosine of pi thirds? These are special angles actually in the first quadrant. Pi 6, also known as 30 degrees, if you want to go degrees on this thing. But this is calculus class. We're in the radians. What's the sine of pi 6? What's the sine of 30 degrees?
1/2.
Very good. What is the cosine of pi 6? Very, very good. Square root of 3 over 2. What is the sine of pi 4? Ah, things are coming back to you guys. Good. Square root of 2 over 2. What's the cosine of pi 4? Square root of 2 over 2. Cosine and cosine. 45 fourths, same thing as 45 degrees. So your sine and cosine are going to be the same thing because the opposite and the adjacent are the same numbers. What about pi thirds? What is the sine of pi thirds? Square root of 3 over 2. And what's the cosine of pi thirds? 1/2. Because as pi 6 is 30 degrees, pi thirds is 60 degrees, and you got your famous 30, 60, 90 triangle, so the numbers end up being the same except flip-flop. Does that make sense? I'm coming back to haunt you on that. Now that we've just a little slight review of things you're supposed to know from high school that most people have forgotten. All right, here we go. Let's go back over here to this problem. All right. I want you to find g prime of pi 6. It's a game. G of x is equal to what? G of x is equal to f of x times cosine of x. Because I want to discuss to you with you guys this problem because I stole this one off of Webber. And it's in your future. I know I'm doing the trig a little prematurely, but I'm trying to get you into notation stuff here. What's g of x equal to? It's equal to f of x times, big hint there, cosine of x. So if I want to take the derivative of g of x, which is equal to f of x, here's a hint, times cosine of x, what rule am I going to use? Product rule. And you have to use the product rule, and no calculator is really going to help you out with this one. I can show you calculator technology later. This is straight up knowing your formulas. So to take the derivative of a product, I'm going to use the product rule, which is, luckily we have it memorized with the miniature voice in your head that sounds like me, derivative of the first times the second plus the first times derivative of the second. What's derivative of the first? That would be f prime derivative of the first is f prime of x times the second, just recopy cosine of x, plus the first, which is f of x, times, here it goes, what is the derivative of cosine of x? Be careful. Yeah, derivative of cosine of x is negative sine of x. Now, I did give that one to you guys. And again, I will prove it to you later and try to scare you with the proof on how it was derived. But for right now, just take it as given that derivative of cosine of x is negative sine of x. So here we go. I'm going to clean this up. But here's the deal. I'm interested of this. G prime of pi 6. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to replace all my x's with pi 6. This will be f prime of pi 6 times the cosine of pi 6 plus f of pi 6 times negative sine of pi 6. All I did was replace all my x's with pi 6. Now, here we go. So g prime of pi 6 would be equal to, what is f prime of pi 6? Because here's how you play the game. What's f prime of pi 6? Look at the top. They gave that one to you. What is it? Negative 5. Times, what is the cosine of pi 6? Square root of 3 over 2. We just talked about that just a few seconds ago. Yes, you were supposed to write it down. Here it is again, just in case you forgot. And your mark, set, go. Cosine of pi 6 is square root of 3 over 2. Sine of pi 6 is 1 half. Sine of pi 4 square root of 2 over 2. Cosine of pi 4 square root of 2 over 2. Sine of pi thirds is square root of 3 over 2. Cosine of pi thirds is 1 half. Got them? Good. Pure memorization from trig class. Okay. Plus, what is f of pi 6? They gave that to you. That's 7. Times negative, keep in mind a sign there, what is the sine of pi 6? 1 half. And they do want you to clean this up. So if I clean this up, well, what is negative 5 times the square root of 3 over 2? Well, that didn't work any better than it's just negative 5 square root of 3 over 2. And what is 7 times negative 1 half? Negative what? Okay, but we'll just go fractions on it. Negative 7 halves, minus 7 halves. Does that make sense? And for web work purposes, this is the exact value that they wanted it to be. Does that make sense? So this is a game of playing around with the product rule and later on the quotient rule. We'll do that one in a second. And the idea of using some trig information. But you did have to, and I had to give this to you. We will revisit the trig function stuff later. But I wanted to give you a demonstration of, you know, how important and how powerful these products and quotients are going to be in your future, okay? Especially when it comes to the trig stuff, as well as the other things. All right, so let's take a look at this next problem here. The next problem is this. I want to find what h prime of pi 6 is. Now remember, h of x was equal to what? Sine of x over f of x. So, what rule would you use to take the derivative of h of x? In other words, what is h prime of x equal to? What rule are you going to use? Quotient rule. What's the quotient rule? Let's go through it again, drumming it in your head. Derivative of the top times the bottom minus the top times derivative of the bottom all over the bottom squared. Tell you what, sing along with me because I want you to drum this into your head. It is what? Derivative of the top times the bottom minus the top times the derivative of the bottom all over bottom squared. It's that important. All right, so let's do it again. H prime of x would be the derivative of the top. What's the derivative of sine of x? Let's go back up here. Derivative of sine of x is what? Cosine of x. Derivative of the top, cosine of x, times the bottom, just recopy it, f of x, minus the top, just recopy it, sine of x, times derivative of the bottom. What's the derivative of f of x? F prime of x, clearly. Derivative of f of x, it's just a function, would be f prime of x. All over the bottom, f of x squared. Look at this thing. Understand how powerful these rules are in terms of the words. Now, the book goes through this thing about, you know, what's the quotient rule? F prime times g minus g time minus f times g prime all over g squared. And they drum these rules into your head. But honestly, rules are meaningless if you don't understand where this stuff's coming from. And they're going to change this stuff up to be, okay, I got f divided by g, that's great. What happens when it's q divided by r? Okay? Or q divided by sine of x. Now, all of a sudden, they start getting kind of changed. But if you memorize the words, derivative of the top times the bottom minus the top times derivative of the bottom all over the bottom squared, you'll always get the derivative right, regardless of what formula you have memorized. So now that's h prime of x. Now I'm after this one. What is h prime of, so is it pi 6? So I'm going to plug in all my x's pi 6. So this would be equal to the cosine of pi 6 times f of pi 6 minus the sine of pi 6 times f prime of pi 6 all over f of pi 6 squared. So far so good? Now, let's see what you guys memorized or either looked up. I still have it up here at the top. But this one you need to know, previous math classes, what's the cosine of pi 6? Cosine of pi 6 is what? Oh, it's the other one. Square root of 3 over 2 times f of pi 6. F of pi 6 was 7. Minus the sine of pi 6. What's the sine of pi 6? 1/2 times f prime of pi 6, which was given to be negative 5, all over f of pi 6, which is 7 squared. Now, the last thing you got to do is you got to clean this guy up. And I would accept this. This is 7 times the square root of 3 over 2 would be 7 square roots of 3 over 2. A minus times a negative is a positive. 1/2 times 5 is 5/2. All over, what is 7 squared? 49. And you can leave it like that. That's fine with me. The exact value. I mean, officially, I could make the 49 over 1 invert, multiply, and distribute the fraction. But this is good enough. All right. How are some more interesting ways that they can make me do these product rules and quotient rules and stuff? Again, the whole purpose of the things that I'm showing you guys is to drill into your head the product rule. Drew the first times the second plus the first time, drew the second. And the quotient rule. Drew the top times the bottom minus the top, trying to drew the bottom all over the bottom squared. They're going to ask you for stuff like this. Basic rules. Your job in number one, on the part A here, is they gave you a chart. They didn't give you a function. They just gave you a chart. They gave you a chart about F and G, and also F prime and G prime. And they gave you the chart with particular values plugged into it. You were supposed to find, in number one, F times G prime evaluated at negative 1. This is also a notation concept here. What's inside the parentheses? F times G. Prime means I'm going to take derivative of a product. So what is this equal to? Product rule. What's the product rule? Derivative of the first, evaluate at negative 1, times the second, g, evaluate at negative 1. What is it? Plus f, evaluate at negative 1, times derivative of the second, g prime at negative 1. It is derivative of the first times the second plus the first times derivative of the second. Does that make sense? You see me using the rule. I didn't have this thing memorized in terms of F prime times G type mess. I never have that memorized. I have the words memorized. The words make so much more sense, especially later on when I'm going to do these combo rules. I'm going to have quotients inside of products and stuff like that. They're going to get really nasty very, very soon. But now, to do this particular problem off of web work, what are we going to do? We're going to plug in the numbers here, reading the chart. What is f prime of negative 1? Negative 1's over here. So this is your x values. Here are your functional values here. What's f prime of negative 1? Negative 3. What is g of negative 1? There's g of negative 1 is negative 1 plus f of negative 1. F at negative 1 is 1 times g prime at negative 1. G prime of negative 1 is negative 1. Now all I got to do is just crunch it out. What's negative 3 times negative 1? Positive 3. What is 1 times negative 1? What is 3 minus 1? The answer that I would put in the blank is 2. Does that make sense? All right. This next one, web worked through it, people. And people, this is amazing. Out of all the stuff that I gave them, this is the one that people screwed up on. What is this? F of negative 1 divided by g of negative 1 plus 5. Do you see primes on this thing? No, they didn't ask you to take a derivative. You're supposed to just crunch out the functional value. But notice the parentheses. So this would be equal to f of negative 1. Straight up. F at negative 1 is what? 1 divided by parentheses g of negative 1. G of negative 1 is negative 1 plus, this is just a constant, 5. According to the order of operations, what am I going to do first? I'm going to do inside my parentheses the negative 1 plus 5. What is negative 1 plus 5?
4.
So what's my answer? 1 over 4. And that's pretty much all I can do. Does that make sense? You see, it was the order of operation things that start screwing people up and stuff. They would give me the answer of just 4 and couldn't figure out what is wrong. I said, you lost your parentheses. Does that make sense? All right. What about next guy? This is the addition rule. I'm practicing all the rules. How do you take the derivative of adding and or subtracting? What do? I take derivative of each one. Derivative of f, evaluate negative 1, plus derivative of g, evaluate negative 1. This is my rule for addition and subtraction. Adding, subtracting, you take derivative of each term. Does that make sense? What is f prime of negative 1? F prime evaluated negative 1 is what? Negative 3. Plus, what's g prime of negative 1? Negative 1. What is negative 3 plus negative 1? Negative 4. What about next one? D, f minus g prime of negative 1. Well, again, applying my rule here, this is equal to, when you have a difference, you just take derivative of each one and subtract them. So f prime of negative 1 minus g prime of negative 1. Luckily, I just did f prime and g prime evaluated negative 1. F prime of negative 1 was what? Negative 3, but what's your sign? It'll be minus. G prime of negative 1 was negative 1. What's a minus a minus? This is negative 3 plus 1, so my answer is? The next one is another product, f times g. Now we are priming it, evaluated at 7. So I'm going to use the product rule because it's a product, f times g, prime. So the product rule would be the derivative of the first, that would be derivative of f, evaluated at 7, times g, the second, plus the first, f, evaluated at 7, times derivative of the second. Derivative of g is g prime, evaluated at 7. So it's derivative of the first times the second plus the first times derivative of the second, all evaluated at 7. So now I'm going to pull this down and use my chart. This, again, is one that people screwed up on, but this was basic arithmetic that most people screwed this one up on. So once you get the rule down, let's go for it. F prime evaluated at 7. What do I get? Negative 163. G prime evaluated at 7. G evaluated at 7. G evaluated at 7 is what? Negative 9. G evaluated at 7. Plus F evaluated at 7 was what? Negative 407. Times G prime evaluated at 7. And I get actually negative 1. It is F prime evaluated at 7 times G evaluated at 7. Plus F evaluated at 7 times G prime evaluated at 7. So now I'm going to kind of do this with the help of a calculator here. What is negative 163 times a negative 9? Well, negative times a negative is a positive, 1467. What is a negative times a negative? Positive 1 times 407 is 407. And so when I add my two numbers together, what do I get? Does that make sense? Yes, ma'am.
So, are we ignoring the prime function?
Ignoring the prime. Oh, no. This is f times g quantity prime. What's inside the parentheses is a product. To take a prime of it, I'm using the product rule. The product rule is you got f is the first, g is the second. You take derivative of the first times the second plus the first times derivative of the second. This is the first, this is the second. Evaluated at 7. Does that make sense? So this is my rule. Derivative of the first is f prime. So derivative of the first would be f prime. Times the second, just copy g, plus the first, f, times derivative of the second, derivative of g would be g prime. All evaluated at 7.
What would be different between that and
g? Oh, that would be, okay. Your question is, what is f, g, evaluate at 7. You'll see in this notation, you see a prime.
No.
So by notation, this would be just f of 7 times g of 7. What is f of 7? Well, I've got to go back and look. What is f of 7? Negative 407. What is g of 7? Negative 9. What is negative 407 times a negative 9? That's a positive 3663. That would have been my answer if I asked you that question. No derivatives, though. But if I used to take derivative of this guy because of that prime right there, I could use the product rule. Do it the first time, second plus the first time, do it the second. No, it's a product rule. When I'm taking the derivative of a product, I don't just get to distribute the prime. That's a common mistake, and that's not calculus rules. If I have f times g, and I want to take derivative of it, and this is a notation, whether it's a function times a function, like 3x squared plus 2 times the square root of x plus 7, or f times g, when I want to take the prime of it, I want to take derivative of the first guy, then multiply him times the second guy, plus the first guy times derivative of the second guy. It's really an offsetting derivative when you're doing this stuff. You take the first, then the second. Last one is this g over f prime evaluated at 0. Clearly, what is this inside the parentheses? Quotient, a prime, which means I'm going to use the quotient rule. So this would be equal to, the quotient rule is the derivative of the top evaluated at 0 times the bottom evaluated at 0. But what is it? Minus the top, g evaluated at 0, times derivative of the bottom, f evaluated prime evaluated at 0, all over the bottom, f evaluated at 0, what? Squared. Using my quotient rule. Now, this is where the chart comes in to get the numerical value here. G prime of 0. There's g prime of 0 is negative 1. Times f of 0. F of 0 is negative 1. Minus g of 0, which is negative 2. We'll notice my wonderful use of parentheses here. Times f prime of 0. F prime of 0 is negative 2. All over f of 0, negative 1 squared. So the only way I'm going to screw this problem up now is screwing up my signs. All right, what's negative 1 times negative 1? Positive 1. What is negative 2 times negative 2? Positive 4, so that'll be a minus 4. All over, what's negative 1 squared? Positive 1. What is 1 minus 4? Negative 3 over 1, which makes the answer negative 3. Of course. Does that make sense? Don't lose you guys anywhere. But it takes practice, and you'll get frustrated with web work because you type it in. Oh, you screwed up one parenthesis in the wrong spot or you got the prime in the wrong space. And next thing you know, you'll be having this thing 142 times trying to get web work done for you. Look at some other problems we can, what's the word I can use? Harass you with on web work. All right, here's a great harassing web work problem here. Because people get frustrated with this one. That's why I put it on this stuff here. The graphs of the functions f, given in blue, but of course I didn't type it in color, so what the heck. Given in blue, and g given in red, I'll label this, and given in blue, and f given in red. Suppose that u prime of x is equal to f of x times g of x, and v prime of x is equal to f of x divided by g of x. Find the following. All right. I gave my hint was down here on my notes. F is the guy on the top function. So I got two functions here. One's on top, one's on bottom. Here's f. It's a piecewise function. Here's f on top, and here's f on top. G is on bottom, so this thing is G here, this thing is G over here. So G, F is on top up here, and G is on bottom down here. All right. You're supposed to look at this graph and tell me what is U prime 1. All right, how you do it? Here we go. U of X is equal to F of X times G of X. You with me? F of x times g of x. How would you take derivative of f of x times g of x? What rule would you use? Product rule. So u prime, labeling is everything, is the derivative of the first, u f prime of x times the second, g of x, plus the first f of x times root of the second g prime of x. Product rule, root of the first times second plus the first times root of the second. That's all I did. But we don't want it at x. What's my x value in this problem since I want to find what u prime of 1 is equal to? What am I going to do? Right, I'm going to replace all my x's with 1's, and then I'm going to use my chart, my graph. That'll be f prime of 1 times g of 1 plus f of 1 times g prime of 1. Here's the deal. How do I use a graph to figure out what f prime of 1 is and g of 1 and all this other good stuff is? So this is going to be equal to, and I will just draw a little line here because I don't want to mess this thing up from the next problem here. All right, what is f prime of 1? First off, find 1 and go up here to f. Here's f. What is f of 1? F is the y-coordinate. F is the y-coordinate, right? What would the y-coordinate of this point be if this is the origin down here? 1, 2, 3. So f of 1 would actually be 3. But here's your question before I ask it. Let me see if I can anticipate it. What would f prime of 1 be? Well, here's the deal. We're trying to drum it into your head. When you're taking the derivative from a visual perspective, what is the derivative? You've been programmed personally by me. When the derivative is geometrically talking about it, what is it? Slope of the tangent line. You know these things are all straight, right? So, what is the slope of this line right here? Because that's the slope of the tangent line. Well, look, from one point to the next point, I had to do what? Down 1 over 1. What is the slope of down 1 over 1? Negative 1. So, f prime of 1 would be actually negative 1. Yes, sir?
It says f log function.
Oh, did I really screw that up? Cool being the professor, man. All right, yeah, you're right. I screwed that one up. I wasn't paying attention because I was looking at the clock behind you guys. I got 10 more minutes and I want to get to the next section. So, you're right. So, trust me, I like this look better. F should be on top, G should be on bottom. All right, so now it really is F on top, G on bottom. And we're going to continue with this one. If you want to go back, trust me, you'll well work. Pay attention to this on well work. All right, so let's keep going because I don't want to screw up my numbers now. All right, so keep going here. What is g at 1? What's g of 1? G here, okay, g is the bottom function the way I've described it here. G is right here, 1. So what's the coordinate on that? 1. And what is g prime of 1? What's the slope of that line? You had to go up 1 over 1, so what does that make that line right there? Positive 1. Remember, slope, so rise over run, 1 over 1 is 1. And there's a big old plus here. So how does that clean up? Negative 1 times positive 1 is negative 1, plus 3 times 1 is 3. What's my answer? Positive 2, based on my setup. And thank you for noticing that. Should have noticed it 10 minutes ago, but you did have your hand up for a while. I'm sorry. Right. So, does that make sense, though? It's more the idea that I'm really after on this stuff. All right, let's keep going. What about B? They tell me, you got it, v of x is equal to f of x divided by g of x, right? So if I want to know, so v of x is equal to f of x over g of x. So here we go. I want to know what v prime of x is going to be. But so what rule would I have to use here? Quotient rule, which is the root of the top times the bottom minus the top times the root of the bottom. What? All over the bottom squared. Does that make sense? But what I really want to have is not v prime of x. I'm just trying to get the rule down. Now I want v prime of 1. This will be equal to f prime of 1 times g of 1 minus f of 1 times g prime of 1 all over g of 1 bottom. I replaced my function, just replace all my x's with 1. So therefore, v prime of 1 would be equal to f prime of 1. What was f prime of 1? Here's 1. What was f prime of 1? That slope of that line right there is what? Going down, down 1 over 1. So what was that? Negative 1 times g of 1. There's one. G of 1, the G I called it was on the bottom, so that's equal to 1. Minus F of 1. F of 1 was what? 1, 2, well, how many units? 3. Because remember, F is actually the Y coordinate. Times G prime of 1. G prime of 1, this is a the slope of G right here at 1 is right. You had to rise 1, run 1, so that makes it 1. All over G of 1. What was G of 1? 1 squared. So now I just put in my numbers. What is negative 1 times 1? Negative 1 minus 3 times 1 is 3. All over 1 squared, which is 1. So what do I get? Negative 4. Did I lose you guys anywhere? And they're trying to drum in this visual thing. So the functional value is the y-coordinate. The derivative is the slope of the tangent line. So you actually had to look at a graph and figure out what the slope is. Okay? Number 4 here. Here we go. See how good you guys are. Another one of these combo rules. Given that f of x is equal to x to the 12th times h of x, and h of negative 1 is 3, h prime of negative 1 is 6, your mission, find f prime of negative 1. Well, before I can find f prime of negative 1, f of x is equal to x to the 12th times, keyword there, h of x. So f prime of x, to take derivative of it, what rule will I have to use? Product rule. The derivative of the first, derivative of x to the 12th is what? 12x to the 11th. Derivative of the first times the second plus the first, x to the 12th times derivative of the second. Derivative of h of x is h prime of x. Derivative of the first times the second plus the first times derivative of the second. But now I want to evaluate it at f prime, evaluate at negative 1. This will be 12 times negative 1 to the 11th times h of negative 1 plus negative 1 to the 12th times h prime of negative 1. This is equal to 12 times, what is negative 1 raised to the 11th? Notice 11 is odd, power. Negative 1. When you raise, you take negative 1 to an even power, it's positive 1. When you take negative 1 to an odd power, it's negative 1. And what's h of negative 1? Well, they gave me that. H of negative 1 was what? 3. Plus negative 1 to the 12th. Negative 1 to an even power is what? Positive 1. Times h prime of negative 1. H prime of negative 1 is 6. Literally, it's plug and chug. So let's see what kind of math you can do without a calculator. What's 12 times negative 1 times 3? Negative 36 plus 1 times 6 is 6. What's my answer? Negative 30. Does that make sense? Don't lose you anywhere. All right. Section 3.7. 7 minutes to go. Excellent. All right. All right. Again, typing up my notes, and I see my little typos here. All right. You guys are familiar with composition of functions. Composition of functions is the idea of plugging one function into the x of another function, creating bigger and nastier functions. One function into the variable of another function to create a third function. If you were taking the derivative of a composition, look at this and look at it well, because there's a pattern to it. I got f of g of x. You may know this better as f with a little circle, g, that's composition, f of g of x. And you want to take the prime of the composition, f of g of x. But the way you do compositions is it's an outside-inside thing. F is on the outside, g is on the inside. We write this as f of g of x. F is on the outside, g of x is on the inside, and you want to take the prime of it. That's a prime right there. You want to take the root of this thing. According to the rules, it's equal to f prime of g of x times g prime of x. Okay? And I wrote it again for you here. F of x, which is equal to, if I different word here, h of g of x, which is h of g of x, then the derivative would be h prime of g of x times g prime of x. Okay? Or I can have the Leibniz notation. This would be the derivative of g, h of g, h is on the outside, g is on the inside with respect to x, is equal to derivative of h with respect to g times derivative of g with respect to x. That is the Leibniz rule for this. But there's a better rule. If you look up here and look at this answer right here on composition, here is the English of what you're doing. You're going to take the derivative of the outside with the inside stays same. You take the derivative of the inside stays the same. And then you do times the derivative of the inside. This is what we call the chain rule. You take derivative of the outside, inside stays the same, times derivative of the inside. Okay? So let me show you an example of this chain rule. Derivative of the outside, inside stays the same, times derivative of the inside. All right. I got f of x is equal to this. This is now the functions are going to get a lot harder. I got f of x is equal to the square root of 5x to the fifth plus 2x. First thing you want to do is clean it up. I don't do square roots. What's a square root? Half a power. So this is equal to 5x to the fifth plus 2x raised to the what power? Half power. Now, here is the trick. And the amazing thing is how many students mess this up, and it's a very simple trick. Stop, pause, hesitate, and look at the function and tell me what you see. I see 5x to the fifth plus 2x on the inside. This 1/2 power is raised on the outside. Does that make sense? I see insides and outsides. Because we're going to do all this combination rule stuff, you need to stop and look at it and think about what you actually see. I see half on the outside, 5x to the fifth plus 2x on the inside. I see outsides and insides. That means I'm going to use the chain rule. What is the chain rule? You take the derivative of the outside. Inside stays the same. Leave the inside alone. The inside stays the same. So what's derivative of a half a power? How do I take derivative of that? What's my rules for derivative of powers? You bring the 1/2 out front. The inside, 5x to the fifth plus 2x stays the same. Just recopy it. But raised to the what power? Negative 1/2. Derivative of the outside, inside stayed the same. Then you do times the derivative of the inside. The inside was this 5x to the fifth plus 2x. What's the derivative of that miss? 25x to the fourth plus 2. And that is my answer. Okay? But of course, you could clean them up if you wanted to. And that's what I did for you guys down here. Let's take a look at it. Where does a negative exponent go? On the bottom. What is actually is a half a power? Square root. So that would be a square root on the bottom. And that's what I did. The 2 is already on the bottom, so I rewrote it as a square root with this stuff on the bottom, times, and there's the derivative of the inside. But this is what we're looking for. Does that make sense? And honestly, if you left the answer and at this stage of the game like this, we're ecstatic about that. This is exactly what we want to see, because I get to see that you actually know the rules. Drew the outside, inside stays the same time, drew the inside. Let's do one more. And then I'll pick it up next time. Here we go. Don't forget to label your derivatives. Take a look at this next guy. I've got f of x is equal to 6x cubed plus 8 raised to the 11th power. Stop, pause, hesitate, and tell me what you see. I see 6x cubed plus 8x on this inside parenthesis thing here. I got that 11th power on the outside, which means I'm going to use the chain rule. The derivative is labeled f prime of x. You could also use the Leibniz notation, df over dx, if you want to. Chain rule. Derivative the outside. Inside stays the same time derivative the inside. Derivative the outside. Outside has the 11th power. To take derivative of something to the 11th power, the power pops out front. The inside, 6x cubed plus 8 stays the same, but you have to raise it to the what, taking derivative of the outside? Raise to the 10th power, derivative of the outside, inside stays the same, times, and I can use parentheses or bracket, I'm just trying to emphasize, times a new function here, times the derivative of the inside. What's derivative of 6x cubed plus 8? 18x squared. And there's my rule. Does that make sense? Did I lose you guys anywhere? Now, of course, you can clean it up all over the place. But one last thing. Take a look at this bottom one down here. This is where we're going with the stuff. So don't miss Wednesday's class, snow or no snow. All right? Here's the deal. You've got a product rule. I see product. But I also see a square root, which means it's 2.5 power on the outside with the 5x, so x to the fifth plus 5 on the inside. This is a combination. I got chain rules with product rules. The trick on this one is, what's the big picture? And you can read it and tell what the big picture is. This is the square root of x to the fifth plus 5 times 8x cubed minus 1. With that times in the middle, the big picture is a product rule. Product rule, I'm taking the product rule, and then when I take the root of the first guy, I can use the chain rule. We're going to start taking combination rules.
So
study hard. Product. Get rid of the square root, make it 0.5 power, and then do the product rule on it. But when I take rid of the first guy, I actually have to use the chain rule. The outside, inside, stay the same time, do the inside. We'll work on this next time. Study hard. See you guys then. Thank you.